Hello everyone, good evening. This is Dr. Megha from Crownit. How have you all been throughout, the corona and preparing for your NEET MDS exams? I hope it's all going well. Today we will be taking up an important chapter in oral medicine and radiology. It is kind of an integrated topic and it is called salivary gland disorders. I will be walking you through this whole concept in parts, that is the diagnosis, then the treatment part, then the individual diseases as such, their signs and symptoms, and how would you go about tackling them. Basically, the idea behind the lecture is to get you through any kind of questions they ask in the NEET MDS exam, and also in the clinical aspect where a patient with a salivary gland disorder or a suspected salivary gland dysfunction walks into your clinical practice or your department, you should be able to give them a very organized and accurate treatment, also at least a diagnosis, and refer them to the appropriate person. All right, so let's take it up. And before starting, I expect that and assume that all of you are familiar with the salivary gland anatomy, physiology, the biochemistry of saliva and its functions, and its role in keeping the oral environment healthy and organized so that there are no such, added problems coming into the oral environment due to problems in the saliva. All right, so let's start with the session. The first question, I just put the question first to keep you awake and, make it a little interactive. So the first question is that the most likely salivary gland associated with the picture is, any answers? Jaydev says B, and somebody called High Dentist say D. And yes, good evening, everyone. Okay. And Jaydev has got it right. Okay. So we know that there are three pairs of the major salivary glands, that is the parotid, submandibular, and the sublingual. But we tend to not give attention to the minor salivary glands and the things that are associated with them. Okay, and there are a huge number of them, that is about 600 to 1000 in the human oral cavity, and it is also extending into the tracheobronchial tree. All right, there are about three sets of minor salivary glands on the tongue, okay, which are a little noted. Apart from that, these other 600 and 2000 are distributed throughout the oral cavity in multiple places, and they take names from the place where they are located. Like say, they are located on the labial part or the buccal part, lingual, palatal, and the retromolar part. All right. Next, the three pairs of salivary gland that are noted, the minor salivary glands noted on the tongue, are called glands of Weber, that is found along the lateral border of the tongue, the glands of von Ebro surrounding the circumvallate papillae, and the glands of Blandin and Nunn, also known as the anterior lingual glands, and are found in the anterior ventral tongue. Okay, so there is this finding or research going on, and a few articles also have been published on the same, that the mucoceles are common in this glands of Blandin and Nunn because of their position, where it is more prone to trauma. Okay, so there is this article on the Triple O journal where you can go check it. It is saying they have observed a number of people who have had this mucocele on the ventral surface of the tongue. All right, and they have come to a conclusion that these mucocele were more having the female predominance. Okay, they had an exophytic mass with a polypoid appearance. And histopathology majorly was a mucus extravasation type of trauma. So this question itself would lead to multiple questions per se, where it will take you to the mucocele of associated with the glands of Blandin and Nern are mucus extravasation type or retention type, etc., etc., then you can be, you know, the most of them were mucus extravasation type because they're more prone to trauma. All right. So moving on. Okay, the next question is related to the physiology of saliva secretion. The question is, when a nerve to the salivary gland is stimulated, the transduction of this signal to increase the formation of saliva is first brought about by the release of which of the following substances? Your options are A, noradrenaline, B, acetylcholine, C, substance P, D, vaso-intestinal peptide, and E, all of the above. What would you say is your guess? One more thing, I would like it if all of you can have a pen and a paper with you when I'm explaining such processes. You can just note it down so as to you can refer it later. Okay, we have Vagisha saying it is B, and Jaidev says E, Ritu says B. All right. So, okay, I think Jaidev wins this one again. So it is all of the above. Okay. So when the saliva secretion is stimulated by both sympathetic and the parasympathetic sources. All right. And the noradrenaline is a sympathetic substance, and the acetylcholine, substance P, and vasointestinal polypeptide are all come from parasympathetic sources. All right. So what happens is when these neurotransmitters arrive at a secretory cell membrane, it binds to and activates a receptor, which may be stimulatory or inhibitory, okay, on the external or the internal surface of the membrane. This activates a guanine nucleotide-dependent membrane protein known as G protein, which activates the inner cytoplasmic surface of the cell. Okay, this will release the or increase the release of the saliva. This mechanism is what is involved. Okay, so next, like I said at the start of the class, our aim would be to actually treat or tackle a patient who comes in with a probable salivary gland anomaly or a disorder. Okay, so there should be a certain set of things that run through your mind when you look at a patient and you think, okay, this could be the problem, or this is what the patient has come to you with. All right, so the possible workup will be like this, as shown in the current slide. A first thing you will have to do is an initial evaluation. Initial evaluation includes what, if you ask me, is when a patient walks, you do a complete scan, like, is the gait of the patient all right? Does the patient have any, you know, outright signs to say that he is sick, nutritionally compromised, etc., etc.? All right. So you have to look at the patient from head to toe, and you have to evaluate the patient as to if there are any systemic complications involved, or are there any outright diseases that you can evaluate by yourself without asking the patient, and make a mental chart of what to ask next. All right. The next would be symptoms of salivary gland disease. Okay. Then would be past and present medical history. Then you will do a clinical examination. Then would come your xylometry, then your xylochemistry, then salivary diagnostics and salivary gland imaging. We will be dealing with each of these headings in a systematic way as and when we go on with the class. All right. So still with me? A few replies wouldn't hurt. All right, so we all know the dominant stimulus for fluid secretion is via muscarinic cholinergic receptors, okay? And factors that increase salivary flow include taste, olfactory stimuli, mechanical stimulation, pain, pregnancy, related hormonal changes, aggression, and sympathomimetic and parasympathomimetic drugs. All right. Menopause-related hormonal changes, stress, antiadrenergic drugs, and anticholinergic drugs will decrease the salivary flow rate. Okay. So whenever you are talking to the patient, even very casually, to take a history, or you're suspecting that this patient might have a salivary gland disease, make sure to ask the patient these very essential questions so that you know that this could be actually affecting the patient's salivary flow. Also, the normal daily production of whole saliva ranges from 0.5 to 1.5 liters in a healthy adult that is not under any medication or has any comorbidities. Okay, this could just come up as a numerical question in one of your exams. So you can just pay a little attention to the same. So when the patient comes, and the most common complaint that he will be having if he has realized that he has a problem with salivary glands is xerostomia, that is dryness in his mouth. Okay, it is the most common presentation, and it is very, very subjective and very difficult to actually, you know, kind of believe or assess the patient based on the same. And we will be seeing in the further sections where we can actually, you know, see how to assess if the patient is, you know, actually feeling it very subjectively due to something like anxiety, stress, or, you know, even just plain dehydration. And we can rule out the possibility. Hyposalivation refers to a quantified reduced salivary flow rate and may or may not be accompanied by xerostomia. This is something that I want you guys to keep in mind. Okay. Just a second, excuse me. Since there are multiple causes of xerostomia and salivary gland dysfunction are numerous, a systemic approach is very, very important, and that is why I stressed on the initial evaluation so much. And it is very important to take a very good medical history from the patient. All right. So patient should be queried regarding duration of their complaint, from what all to ask. If the patient is saying, I am having dryness of the mouth or xerostomia, what all should you ask the patient? You should be asking the patient, how long is the problem persisting for? Whether the condition is progressive, is the condition progressing, you know, day by day, or is it intermittent? Does he feel like, okay, for some time in the afternoon, probably when there's a lot of heat, that he feels that his mouth is drying up, or in the night, and then probably it's becoming all right. Okay. Possible circadian association. There's a very established circadian rhythm with the salivary flow rate and the secretion of the saliva. So it's a probable circadian association as well, because sometimes in the night patients tend to feel that, you know, their mouths are going dry. And severity, which may actually take you directly to the direction of diagnosing the salivary gland disorder the patient has. So is it mild, moderate, or severe? How, you know, how often does he keep sipping water? This is how you should ask in very layman terms to the patient. Usually when you notice that the patient has xerostomia, or even diabetic and anti-diabetic drugs or antidepressants and things like that, the patient tends to keep sipping water and says, my mouth is going dry. So you have to ask in very layman terms and get the history out of the patient, okay? So a thorough examination is a very, very, very essential component of the same. We have to quantify the unstimulated and stimulated salivary flow to actually establish that the patient has salivary hypofunction, which may be leading to xerostomia or hyposalivation. That the rest of the techniques will be discussed as and when we go, okay, along the chapter. Most common causes, like say the patient has told you there is xerostomia, you have asked him from when the complaint is, how severe it is it intermittent, continuous, everything. All right. So when you have asked the patient the same, what will you be doing next is thinking in your mind, then what could this patient possibly have that I can actually relate to the complaint of xerostomia? Okay, so it could be anywhere between medications such as antidepressants, anticholinergics, antispasmodics, antihistaminics, antihypertensives, sedatives, diuretics, and bronchodilators. All right, these are the class of drugs which actually cause hyposalivation and make the patient's mouth go dry. All right, and agents such as caffeine, alcohol, and cigarette smoking can also cause less salivation. And also, system, when you're taking the medical history, you would have known that you can ask for previous history of any malignancies where the patient has received any kind of radiation to the head and neck area where there's a possibility of damage to the salivary glands. All right. So systemic diseases such as diabetes as well, we've discussed this before, and salivary gland masses, psychological conditions such as depression and anxiety can also cause chronic hyposalivation. Okay. So this was actually the part of the initial evaluation where you have asked the patient his medical history, thought in your head as to what this patient has that we can actually relate to the symptoms that he will be having. So once you're talking to the patient, you will be coming to know the one by one, you'll be coming to know that, you know, you can relate one thing to another. So it is very important to talk to the patient within the initial stages after listening to his chief complaint. So now the major symptoms that the patient will tell you also, if he already knows that he has hyposalivation and you have established one of these things in the medical history and the ancient evaluation you have asked, he would say, doctor, my mouth goes dry, then I have difficulty in chewing, swallowing, and sometimes speaking as well. Or he can say, I have a burning sensation in my mouth, I have a chronic sore throat, and he may say, I find swallowing very difficult. And the mucosa will be sensitive to spicy food and whatever he enjoys, and that might compromise the nutrition as well. So that comes again to your initial evaluation where you evaluate the patient and think, okay, he's a little malnourished, what might be the problem? Okay. So these would be what you will be hearing from the patient per se when he says that, you know, he has less saliva in the mouth in his terms. Next. Like I said, then you have to take a pass in the present medical history very nicely, like we discussed earlier, and the drug history and the surgery history and everything. All right. In the past and the present medical history, if you are actually suspecting a salivary gland disorder, it is very important to ask for eye, throat, nasal, skin, and vaginal dryness, because this is a very significant finding. In which of the salivary gland disorders can I get an answer for that, please? Yeah, where do you see the dryness of all the things that I just described now? Yes, Jayadev, it is. Yes, it's Sjogren syndrome. And Bhargavi is asking, ma'am, habit of chronic smoking itself can cause xerostomia after ruling out other causes if not there. Yes, smoking does cause hyposalivation, but there are you need to like take in a lot of factors into consideration as to patient systemic status and everything as well. Okay, I hope that cleared it out. And then there is this list. Past and present medical history is over. Okay, so now before going into the clinical examination, what you will think of now is, what could this B, you have asked the patient everything. Now it is time to formulate a pseudo provisional diagnosis in your head as to gathering all the information from the beginning of your question chart. Okay, so we have asked the patient everything now. So now the table on the right, the table here will be showing you the possible list of diagnosis that could come, but this is still a pseudo provisional diagnosis and it is too early to even make a decision. Okay, so these are the list of diseases or conditions that could lead to salivary gland hypofunction, autoimmune diseases such as chronic graft versus host disease, Sjögren's syndrome, developmental disorders such as salivary gland aplasia, hyperplasia, iatrogenic such as external beam radiation, internal beam radiation, post-surgical, that is adenectomy or ductal ligation that has been done, a Botox injection sometimes, inflammatory disorders such as IgG4 related disease, infectious diseases such as viral include CMV infection, HIV, hepatitis C, granulomatous diseases such as tuberculosis, medication associated. We discussed a whole list of drugs that could cause salivary hyperfunction, neoplastic benign and malignant salivary gland tumors. Non-neoplastic could be sialolithiasis, sialodocytosis and stuff like that. And systemic could be anorexia nervosa, diabetes, chronic alcoholism and sarcoidosis. So now we come to the clinical examination. All right. So now you have seen the whole initial evaluation of the patient. And now is when you're going to actually touch the patient to examine and see what the problem is. The first thing I suggest to do when you are suspecting a salivary gland disorder in a patient is see if the face is asymmetric or it is same. All right. Or it is swollen on both sides. That will give you an idea as to it is a unilateral swelling or a bilateral swelling or what is it. Okay. And in the parotid region and in the floor of the mouth, and the just check for redness, any pus discharge, anything. This is just looking. You're still not touching the patient. So you look for all these signs. All right. Next, most of the times during in cases of parotid swelling, if it is infectious, if you touch the patient, the first thing that you have to notice is the temperature of the skin that is there. All right, the first, it could be if it's a little warm, then it is an active infection. Okay, if it is a normal temperature but there's still a mass, that we will be discussing how to work out a diagnosis, if you know it's a unilateral swelling or a bilateral swelling, if it's infectious what to do, if it is neoplastic what to do, everything in the further stages. The next thing, okay, all right, now the parotid region you have seen, and one more thing that you would be seeing if this patient has salivary hypofunction is the lips would be often dry, cracked and chapped. Okay, the buccal mucosa may be pale and corrugated, the dorsal tongue will appear depapillated, okay, and it may appear erythematous and it might appear erythematous and fissured. Okay, due to the absence of the buffering capacity of the saliva, there is an often increase in the erosive lesions and there will be dental caries. And if there is salivary hypofunction, you will be seeing that the caries will be affecting the root of the teeth and the cusps of the teeth. Okay, so can you everybody with me till now following? It's fine. Is it all right? Okay, so now you have seen the lips, it is dry, chapped and chapped. Then you have seen the tongue, it is bald, fissured and erythematous. There might be a few caries that you're seeing. These are all the obvious signs that there is less saliva than normal in this patient. And now is the time that you will touch the patient. And when you touch the glandular area, that is the parotid or the submandibular, enlarged glands that are painful, the patient will give an obvious eye sign when you actually touch the gland if it is painful. Okay. So if it is painful, then it is indicative of an acute inflammation or a tumor that is secondarily infected. The consistency of the gland should be slightly rubbery, but never hard. Okay. this is the next thing. After the temperature and the pain, the next thing you will be looking at is the consistency of the gland. Neoplasms, either benign or malignant, of the salivary glands usually present as painless masses, but may also present with dull pain suggestive of an inflammation-based process, is what we've seen so far. So the two additional indications. Okay, I think I have a question for that. So next, we have seen so much. So we see that when we touch the patient, let's assume. Let's assume that the patient has an inflammatory process going on, okay? And there is a little inflammation, and thus there is a suspected salivary gland inflammation there, and you have to obtain the patient history and perform the physical examination. This picture depicts here bimanual palpation of the salivary glands. What we do usually is when there is pressure applied on the gland and we look at the orifice, usually there is clear watery saliva that is getting ejected from their respective orifices. Sometimes it will be hazy and flocculent that or pus filled, that could be clearly indicative of an infection. But sometimes when there is obstruction as well, it will appear hazy and there will be a few mucosal cells and food debris that is accumulated, and it will make it look like, you know, flocules of microorganisms. So that could be sterile, but still there would be obstruction in the gland. You have to do a bimanual palpation of the gland to see if the gland is working, is fine, and to see the consistency of the gland. Okay, then to come to the workup or the diagnosis of whatever you have palpated till now, if there's an inflammation, then you have to obtain the patient history and perform physical examination, like we said. If it is a localized disease, it could be acute sialadenitis or recurrent or chronic sialadenitis. All this information you are going to get only when you talk to the patient and take a proper history. All right? So if it is acute sialadenitis, it could be a viral infection, and then you will have to do observation and supportive care. We will be discussing each of these conditions in very much detail in the coming classes. So it is just now to, you know, create a mind map for you as to what to think of when you are dealing with such a patient. And then if it's a bacterial infection, then we will have to do a needle aspiration. Then we will have to culture it and do sensitivity tests and give appropriate antibiotics, xylococcus, and proper supportive care to the patient. All right. So if it is chronic sialadenitis, there is recurrent swelling and there will be gland firmness because there's repeated inflammation and then repair, inflammation repair per se. Then we will have to do the duct evaluation by the use of radiography, xylography, CT, or a xyloendoscopy. Then if it is obstructive chronic sialadenitis, that is a stricture or a xylolith or xylactasia is there, then dilatation, xylodercoplasty, gland excision, antibiotics, and supportive care is very much needed. Non-obstructive chronic sialadenitis is there. We will have to do a salivary gland biopsy. Then rheumatoid serologies. This is probably basically the diagnostician is suspecting Sjögren's, so that we will be doing the same. Rheumatoid serology, salivary analysis, needle biopsy, and it could be Sjögren's syndrome or sarcoidosis or lymphoma or fungal disease. All right. So everybody with me, so have we successfully created a mind map as to how to deal with a patient when he just plain comes into your clinic and says that, you know, I have dryness of the mouth? Then this is the mind map that we have to go about into treating him, or, you know, coming at the correct diagnosis. It's not clear, then I will be posting the picture on Telegram. You can just have a look at it. You mean the picture or the explanation? Okay, the picture is it. So let me just post it on Telegram. You guys can have a look at it. So next, if it's a parotid swelling alone, basically this flowchart depicts the how to work up for a neoplasm. That was for an infection. This is for a neoplasm. All right. So when there is a parotid swelling, that is very obvious, and you have palpated it. Now you are thinking, you have to think in these terms. if the swelling is diffuse, if it's unilateral or bilateral. All right. If it's unilateral or bilateral, if it's bilateral, then investigate for systemic diseases such as diabetes mellitus, Sjögren syndrome. Even chronic alcoholism would cause enlargement of the parotid glands bilaterally. All right. Then unilaterally, if it's somebody that is admitted for a long time or chronically ill, then you have to culture the. If it's a diffuse unilateral swelling, then probably it is an infectious swelling. Then again, what we saw in the previous slide, then you can do the culture and give proper supportive care. If it's somebody that you're seeing on a, you know, like probably came with the same complaint to your facility, then the same thing goes, but just follow it up very properly. All right. Then if it is a discrete mass, firm and fixed to the underlying tissues, then you have to investigate it very properly with the advanced diagnostic aids and imaging to know its extent. All right. So we'll be seeing about the neoplasms also in the later stages very in a very great detail. So if it's a neoplasm, then if you think that is a very discrete mass, it is fixing to the underlying tissues, there's a little induration also that is seen, then what you could, and also probably associated with lymphadenopathy, then what you could probably do is, if you've ruled out a bacterial infection, then you have to assess for facial paralysis, because we all know the facial nerve traverses through the parotid gland in between the deep and the superficial lobe. So we have to assess for facial paralysis, look for close signs of facial paralysis, assess for cervical lymphadenopathy, because there might be a few matted fixed lymph nodes in the cervical region, and fixation of the mass to the overlying skin or deep structures. All of this have to be very carefully observed. And then if you feel like this is a malignancy, then go ahead for a diagnostic imaging such as ultrasonography, CT or an MRI, and we will discuss as to which imaging modality is the best for assessing each kind of conditions that we are discussing right now. Then please obtain a biopsy and do an FNAC. If it's a benign lesion, then you can do just observation and probably a surgical excision if the patient is cosmetically concerned. Or if it's a malignant lesion, then a surgical excision and appropriate care in terms of radio and chemotherapy, and depending on how much metastasis has occurred, then we will have to go ahead and do the appropriate kind of treatment. Okay, so coming back to the clinical examination part, this is a question that was, you know, just put to see how much you will be probably knowing about a few little much in depth in the assessment of salivary hypofunction. The below depicted tests are used in the diagnosis of which symptom of salivary dysfunction. So, any answers? Your options are oral dryness, candidiasis, burning mouth syndrome, and none of the above. Guys, I'm waiting for the answer. Anybody? Is a slide with a lipstick mark, teeth, and a tongue blade on the cheek visible to all of you? Okay, guys, I'm waiting for answers. All right, so these are two very specific tests that depict oral dryness. Okay, it is called the lipstick test and the tongue blade sign. All right, it is. Informer in the lipstick sign, right? The presence of lipstick or shed epithelial cells on the labial surfaces of the anterior maxillary teeth is indicative of reduced salivary flow. Because usually when you're applying lipstick and it gets on the teeth, the saliva just takes it off when you close your mouth. But normally this is not happening in the patient where there is hypofunction. The tongue blade sign results when the tongue blade is pressed gently and then lifted away from the buccal mucosa, it adheres to the tissue. So this is something chair side that you could do with the patient and then assess how much, you know, it is like kind of sticking, and you can get an actual idea as to there is salivary hypofunction before you get into like, you know, complicated tests like measuring the salivary flow rate, or, you know, doing a salivary assay as to if this pH is all right or if its components is all right and stuff like that. So these are two very basic tests that you could do chair side to actually assess the salivary hypofunction. Next, okay, so now what we can do is we will have to, there is hypofunction. We have seen that probably with the lipstick test, or let's assume there's hypofunction. We have seen that with the lipstick test or the tongue plate sign and everything. So next we will have to actually check if it is a concerning amount. Then we will have to actually check how much the patient is, you know, how much saliva is being actually produced. So we could do it two ways, stimulated and unstimulated. Okay. Normal people without any comorbidities or not on any medication. Usually, you know, complain of a dry mouth when the salivary flow reduces below like 40 or 50% below like average or normal. Okay, so it is very important to assess both stimulated and unstimulated salivary flow when investigating a complaint of xerostomia. The main methods of whole saliva collection include draining, suction, spitting, and absorbent sponge methods. All right, we will be seeing the different salivary collection methods. And here's a question for you. Just give me a second. What could be the answer to this question? Identify the saliva collection method depicted below. Your options are Lashley's cup, Carlson Crittenden collector, absorbent swab, and the salivary drainage, both A and B. So Jaidev says A. Monica says A. Okay, so Jaidev says B, is it? Okay, that was the B. Okay, any other guesses? It's actually both A and B. This is a Carlson Crittenden collector. All right. It is used for parotid saliva collection. There will be two metal cups with two outlet tubes. The inner cup collects the saliva and the outer cup is connected to the vacuum. Basic design was modified by Lashley. So it is also called a Lashley's cup. So it is both A and B, and that is answer E. Okay. So coming to the methods of saliva collection, this is something that you have to know and is important, because most recently, Bhargavi, that comes when I'll discuss for Sjögren's syndrome. The draining method, you can just read through the slide a bit, because why it is important to know the methods of collection of saliva and the salivary diagnostics, because this has been like the emerging and the most, you know, kind of the profitable market for many companies now, and saliva is becoming the next choice of diagnostic fluid because it is non-invasive and it's very, very easy to collect. And it is the, I could say, like, say the probably the future, if we could master a few of the biotechnology methods that are already available now, which will be a little improvised in, you know, actually amplifying the quantity of substances that are found in the saliva, then this could be the future diagnostic fluid, and blood could take a second place in the near future. All right. So the draining method is passive and requires the patient to allow saliva. So I think you can just go through the slide and revisit the video when you need it. All right. And the suction method, there is the spitting method, the suction method, the absorbent method. Okay. So all of these are done in their own types. And okay. Individual parotid gland saliva collection is performed by using Karlsson cretidine collector that we saw earlier. The collectors are placed over the stenosine duct orifices or hand in placed with a gentle suction. Okay. Then this was modified by Lashley and called it a parotid cup or a Lashley's cup. It makes possible the collection of parotid fluid uncontaminated by the oral contents. That is the best part of using the Lashley's cup, or a parotid cup, is that we don't get any contaminants and we get pure parotid saliva. Saliva from individual aspirating device or an called a segregator. This I have seen in a couple of questions and like previous year question papers as to how the you would know for the parotid gland that the Lashley's cup or a Karlsson cretidine collector is used, but for the submandibular gland, you wouldn't have paid so much attention, so you can just note this down. The collection of saliva from the submandibular and sublingual glands may be accomplished by using custom-made collectors such as Wolf's collectors. All right, there are a lot of articles on Wolf collectors. You can just have a look at it. So like I was telling you, the saliva could be the future of diagnostics and blood could take a second place. Let us just have a look at, you know, how xylochemistry and salivary diagnostics work. The basic components of the saliva are given in the picture. Of course, more than the components of the saliva, we could say that, you know, the diagnostic abilities of the saliva is actually given by these components on the picture here. The main source could be, of course, the saliva itself with its array of proteins and lipids and whatever, whatnot. Then the oral mucosal cells that gets, you know, kind of mixed with them. The oral microbiota and viruses, blood, some amount of blood, gingival crevicular fluid, and the food that we eat in the form of debris. All of this are incorporated in the saliva and the oral and micro environment, from which we can have a wide number of possibilities as to how we can use saliva as a diagnostic fluid. So coming to using the saliva as diagnostic fluid, we have four major parts. The components could be divided into like four major parts. The transcriptomes, that is the miRNA and the mRNA, RNA, DNA, that is found in the saliva, that of the microbes also and of the patient himself also, and is used in multiple studies across and diagnosis, and also in a few forensic. It also has a few forensic applications. All right. The proteomes, there's a wide range of proteins in the saliva. The metabolome, the lot of metabolites such as vitamins, minerals, etc. are seen. The microbiome, of course, the oral microbiota, which with its components and the secretory components contribute to the salivary composition. All right. So now this table here, these four things contribute in such a way that they become markers for various, you know, things that could actually be assessed with saliva as a diagnostic fluid, such as periodontal disease, oral cancer, pancreatic cancer, lung cancer, breast cancer. A lot of cancers have active studies going on throughout the world where they're trying to use saliva and its components as biomarkers to look at how the cancer is progressing or what stage it is in, or just basic diagnosis as well. So this table here, if you can take a screenshot and keep probably, all right. So we will be able to, you know, you will be able to answer questions on what markers are used in what disease. This is just a very concise part of the same. You will, if you want, there are a lot of articles on the internet available where you could go and you can actually see how many markers are indicated at a particular disease. Okay, so a question based on salivary diagnostics. How, for what purpose is the below depicted testing kit used? The options are HIV, candidiasis, periodontal disease, or diabetes. Can somebody please answer the question? I should be posting the screenshots of the table and the flowcharts on Telegram. You can just have a look at it there. So the answer for this question, please. No. So Ashmi has got it right, and it is A, all right. It's HIV, it's OraQuick, a home test for, and it is FDA approved, and it is called OraQuick Advanced Rapid HIV 1/2 Antibody Test, and it is curated by the OraSure Technologies. So this is a home antibody test where anybody could take very discreetly to check, you know, if they are HIV positive or not. This is what I was talking about when I was telling that saliva is the future of diagnostics if only we master techniques that could amplify the components that are found here. All right, we already have a lot of things like flow cytometry and many more improvements, but still, you know, it would be very, very easy if we could, you know, amplify and actually get exact results, and a lot of studies have been going on for the same. While we are on the same subject, there's another kit that is available that is called OraSure, and this is also used in HIV. It's a used for HIV testing. And this is called MyPerioPath, okay? And it is used to quantify specific periodontal disease-associated bacteria and also high-risk human papilloma virus. So it's been so easy. You can just take it home like a home pregnancy test and you can actually do it. And it would be much easier because it's non-invasive like blood, and you can do it by yourself. So the next part about the whole assessment is your salivary gland imaging, all right? So imaging plays a very, very important role in actually coming at the right diagnosis. Now your pseudo provisional diagnosis after imaging would come to a proper solid provisional diagnosis, all right? So you can see the table. There's the modality, indications, advantages, disadvantages. You can just read through it. I shall give you 2 minutes. And of course, we shall be going through each imaging modality and its advantages and disadvantages in very much detail in the later classes, and how each of these works, or you know, gives us an upper hand in diagnosing the patient. So once you're done, then the OraSure is for HIV, then MyPerioPath is for periodontal disease. Oh, we're not talking about HIV transmission though. The salivary gland disorders of HIV patients will be discussed later in the later stages. Then we can discuss all this, Bhargavi. All right. So please read through the next part of the table as well, the CT and the MRI part of it. Let's come to each. There will be a discussion later on how each of these common systemic disorders are affecting salivary glands. Then we can discuss how HIV gets transmitted, how it is seen in saliva, then diabetes, how it affects, hypertension, how it affects, or each of these medications, how it affects the saliva, the salivary composition, etc., etc. All right. So let's go in an order. Now we're doing the imaging, then let's finish imaging, then let's go to individual disorders and we can decide. Let's not go off track is what I feel. Is that all right? Okay, so if everybody has run through the table soon, and then so we will do a basic algorithm for diagnostic imaging just because the imaging modalities is available with us. So there's a lot of radiation exposure involved to the patient and the doctor as well, of course. And there's the cost involved to do a CECT. It would cost you around, thousands of rupees. So you will just not go about prescribing any kind of diagnostic imaging without actually coming to a proper conclusion as to what it exactly requires. You need to make a problem statement. Like I told you, you have examined the patient. Say the patient has a bacterial sialadenitis and it is very clear there is pus discharge and there might be a mild obstruction. So first you could just do a plain film radiography in your own office to check. And then if it's still inconclusive, then we go to higher and higher imaging modalities. All right. So what we do is first we do a plain film radiography by rule. But if it's a malignant or a fixed, like I said, it's a fixed mass or a matin mass, then you will not be able to visualize anything completely with plain film radiography, and that comes totally obsolete. So then you will have to, go to a very higher imaging modality. But after plain film radiography, if you find that there is an obstruction or a probability for an obstruction, then you could do a sialography. All right. And then if the patient is allergic to iodine or if you suspect malignancy, then go ahead and do an MRI, ultrasound, or a contrast enhanced CT or a CT. CT is the best modality to detect sialolytes, but then sialolytes can also be, in the submandibular gland, can also be detected with probably occlusal radiographs. So you have to make your decision very, very clearly and draw the line as to where what is necessary. And MRI and ultrasound is used to detect soft tissue changes of the malignancy, and the complete extent of the malignancy can also be known in the same. All right. So once you've done the workup, so this is a little deviation. So let's end a little fun too. So I just want to ask you guys and look at the question here. Observe the picture depicted below. The patient is giving history of extreme stress and anxiety. However, just to be sure, a plain film radiograph, that's what I was talking about. Don't jump to conclusions and get going to do imaging modalities and techniques without taking a proper history and an examination. So just to be sure, a plain film radiograph was taken prior to intraoral examination in which a deep antigonial notch with exostosis was noted. What is the most likely diagnosis? Just observe the picture very nicely and just let me know what you think this patient might have. Doesn't it look like there are two bulges here, like in the parotid region? So what do you think this patient might have? Okay, any more guesses? Just observe the patient. This is what I meant. When the patient walks in, you have to observe, take proper history, do a very nice clinical examination, and then go about doing imaging. Any other guesses? I'll give another 2 minutes to guess. No. Okay, here are your options. Let me make it a little easy for you. No. Look at the question. What does it say? No. It's mesenteric hyperplasia. There are very clear things there, right? There's a deep anticornean notch and there is an exostosis of the angle of the mandible notic. So that is pathognomonic of mesenteric hyperplasia. It is usually seen in young adults who suffer from anxiety and depression. In the question also, it was written that, you know, the patient is suffering from anxiety and depression when taking a history. So the basic idea of this question was to, without taking a proper history and looking at everything properly in nicely, if you had just checked intraorally, you would have seen some bruxism there, right? So it is mesenteric hyperplasia. So when you're tackling such questions, it is very, very important to be careful. Okay, both when you're tackling such patients also and when you're tackling such questions also. Okay, so now plain film radiographs are useful when clinical impression is supported by history and suggests the presence of xyloliths or stones or calculi or some sort of an just a second. And some sort of, you know, there's an obstruction. We have noted that. So you can see that occlusal cross-sectional or occlusal radiographs will give you a good impression of, or an IOPA will show you xylolates in the submandibular region very easily. Okay. So the next question. Parotid xylolates are more difficult to demonstrate than submandibular variety because. Answers for this. The answer is that the stenosis duct is more tortuous and hence it will not be seen, and the anterior border of the masseter also kind of covers it. All right. So a few take home points on plain radiography or the plain film radiography for salivary glands. You can note it down if you would like. Panoramic and conventional PA radiographs, that is posterior anterior skull radiographs, may demonstrate bony lesions, thus eliminating salivary pathosis from the differential diagnosis. So it is very, really very important to survey the radiograph properly. All right. I'll come to this question. Then the plain film radiography may demonstrate a deep anticornean notch, overdeveloped mandibular angle, and exostosis on the outer surface of the angle in cases of masseter hypertrophy. All right. Several xylolids may be present at various locations. It is expedient to use about half the usual exposure to avoid overexposure of the xylolids. But when you do this, the poorly calcified xylolids, however, this technique is limited only by the fact that 20% of the xylolids of the submandibular gland and 40% of those of the parotid gland are not well calcified at all. Therefore, if you reduce the exposure, they might appear just radiolucent and it won't be visible at all in plain films. All right. Radiolucent xylolids are rarely found in the sublingual glands. Xylolids in the anterior two-thirds of the submandibular duct are typically imaged with a cross-sectional occlusal projection like we saw in the previous slide. All right. The posterior part of the duct is demonstrated with a posterior oblique view wherein the head of the patient is tilted back and maximally inclined toward the unaffected side. Parotid xylolids are more difficult to demonstrate than the submandibular variety. Okay. And that comes to our next question. And tell me, why is it? Why is it? Okay. So, I like I said, the stance in duct is more tortuous. And the anterior part of the masseter covers it, and it goes to the buccinator muscle is also there, and hence it is very difficult to view it on the radiographs. As a rule, only sylolids in the anterior part of the duct, anterior to masseter muscles, can be imaged on an intraoral film. To demonstrate sylolids in the anterior part of the duct, an intraoral film packet is held with a hemostat inside the cheek, as high as possible in the buccal sulcus and over the parotid papilla. All right. The central ray is then directed perpendicular to the center of the film. I shall find an illustration for this and show it to you in the next class. To demonstrate sylolids in the submandibular gland, the lateral projection. Okay, let me just. So, okay, once we're done with this, let's go to the next question. Identify the extraoral imaging technique depicted below, and which of the following are the modifications required to image a sylolid in the same? Okay, so what are your answers for the same? Your options are opening the mouth, extending the chin, depressing the tongue with the index finger, and all of the above. And why so it is necessary to actually do all of this? Can I get the answers, please? Yes, Jayadev, it is correct. It is a lateral oblique radiograph of the mandible. What happens is when you don't do all of these things in the radiograph, that is opening the mouth of the patient, extending the chin of the patient, and depressing the tongue with an index finger, what happens is the lower border of the mandible could superimpose on your sylolid and you will never be able to see it very properly. So this just stops us where we have just learned about plain film radiography. And also to visualize parotid sylolids, you could take a I'm so sorry. One second. You could always take a PS skull projection with cheeks puffed out, and you know where you can see the. And you can see the sylolid there because the cheeks are like kind of puffed out. All right, I will show you a picture next time. This technique might also, you know, kind of give you the intraglandular sylolids that are present as well. So far we have seen how to do the initial workup for a patient who comes in with just a complaint of hyposalivation, and we have come till taking plain radiographs to rule out a few things like is it obstruction or a malignancy or an inflammatory process or what it is. All right. So in the next coming classes, we will be going ahead. I will be taking sylography next, and then all the advanced imaging techniques and how they come into a play when salivary gland diseases are concerned. Okay. So after that, we will be taking up individual disorders of the salivary gland. And then the systemic implications on the salivary gland and its functions, all right, and how the salivary gland hypofunction will systemically affect the patient as well. So that will complete the whole chapter. I think we will need another 7 to 8 classes on the same topic, but we will be finishing the same. So thank you all. Have a very nice evening. Stay home, keep safe. All the best to all of you.